this girl is a star. And I remember Jackie and Candy were nice. So plucked because they were the drag queen stars. And they, when you got around to doing Women in Revolt, they were the women who were revolting against
I know they
you.
Were.
They were so jealous.
Yeah, it was really horrible on the set. The set, any sets were always somebody's apartment or somebody, you know. By that time, the three of us were just, you know, not really getting along. And I was just so intimidated by Curtis because, you know, how that I just sort of, like, didn't even give anything to the movie. And and I was just said, to hell with it, let them have it, you know. Mm-hmm. And it shows, but it's still a hysterical movie. I wish it would come out.
It's a historical movie, too. Yeah, I wish it would come out on video. I mean, they were great. Candy Darling was probably the most beautiful transvestite that ever lived. Not, of course, counting Holly, but, I mean, she... And you had this
different type, different type of beauty.
She was the Nordic blonde.
Very ethereal, very, yes. Very soft and
I want to go to the picnic, Mom. You know, and I was her mother, and she actually really did have a mother. She lived, it was very interesting about you. You and Candy used to take the Long Island Railroad and go out to Candy.
Massapequa
Park and get off and go to stay at Mrs. Darling's home. How were you dressed when you arrived? I mean, did you go out in drag?
See, at that time I was living with this guy as his wife in Queens.
Oh, right,
and
right.
I was doing homeless. I was working at Saks Fifth Avenue as a model.
That's right.
So you know, so Candy would borrow my clothes and then just wear them and when I get them back they'd be all shredded.
Because she was a lot bigger than you.
Oh.
She was huge.
But for some reason, Candy always got beaten up. I mean, she'd love to get beaten up, you know?
That was one of her hobbies.
Oh, honey, they beat me and they read me and all this stuff. You know, well, Candy, if you stop acting like that, they won't. You know, she'd be hitchhiking from Massapequa Park to Brooklyn, or that's where I was living, in Brooklyn. But she'd be hitchhiking, and then when they try to, like, you know, have sex with her, she'd go, I don't do that. she'd be making out with them. She'd have her tongue down their throats, and then, you know, then she'd stop them when they try to, you know, so, like, half the time they'd throw her out of cars, you know. Die, you tramp. Then she'd call me, Holly, you'll never guess what happened to me. And where are you? I don't know. Oh God!
So, what was the house like when you got there? I mean, you were
the mother's house.
Yeah,
it was a little house, and there was a fireplace, and she
there was a
beautiful. There was a beautiful picture of the mother over the fireplace, and she looked just like a glamorous 1940s movie star. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, what is that movie with this? The picture.
Laura?
Of Laura.
Laura.
It was like that.
Uh-huh.
It was just unbelievable. This woman looked like Candy Lamont.
Yeah, and you think Candy's mother sort of wanted her to be
this blonde
movie star.
Well, what happened, and then in one entire room was like magazines piled to the ceiling, Vogue, Bazaar, you know, movie magazines. It was like sort of like an obsession there. And that's all they talked about was like movie stars and stuff. So, you know, and they lived by themselves. There was no, you know, it was just Candy and her mother. So, you know, I'm sure she didn't, you know, fight it one bit. I mean, you know,
yeah.
She felt like.
Because there was, in your book, you said, I hadn't heard that about Candy's mother before, that you felt that Candy's mother sort of
wanted her to be her.
Yeah,
you know, because
yeah.
She at one point wanted to be a movie star, and then so she was living vicariously through Candy.
Yeah, I had, you know, I was just, for years I was trying to write a book about Candy, and I never, I'm so glad you wrote your book, which we're sitting in front of, A Lowlife in High Heels, The Holly Woodlawn Story. Because,
I love your set. It's too famous.
It cost a fortune, darling.
Yeah.
Hours and hours of carpenters hammering to make this fabulous set behind us. So, but I'm glad this is all down in print for, you know, because it's history.
Honey, oh, God, trying to remember all this was a beat in itself. Yeah.
Well.
Honey, because so much of that part of my life was just one big blur.
A blur, right. Well, you bring the days in Max's Kansas City after your stardom in trash very vividly to life. Now, I never went into Max as much. I was, you know.
Yeah. Oh,
I was too scared, you know. I went up to Marie Nemo, you know, who you do mention, the Paul Ambrose, brought me up to the factory
she
once.
She's still alive.
She's still alive, too. Yes, she's I saw her on the subway the other day. And she brought me up there, and I thought, this is a funeral parlor. If I stay here, I will die. And
at Max's?
No, at Warhol, at the factory. Uh-huh. So I split. But tell us about Andy Warhol. I mean, you had a very complicated relationship with him.
Well, actually, okay, but see, in the beginning, I mean, there was no relationship because I when I did Trash, I was working with Paul Morrissey. And Warhol
was
not
the director of Trash.
Who directed, yeah. And
And he had been shot already and stepped back and let Paul...
And this was... It was 68. Andy was shot by this mad dyke.
Yeah.
And And before that period, the factory was like, you know, Speed Freaks and all the Vivas and Ultraviolets and everything was in Edie Sedgwick. You know, it was like, ah. But right after that, it became a business.
And
Candy, Jackie, and I were the last ones in that were sort of like, you know, on the deranged side.
Yeah.
And Andy just completely became totally withdrawn from everything, and you know, that's when everybody else like took over the factory, Fred Hughes, and you know, And Andy, you know, I just didn't know him very well. It was always like, oh, you look glamorous, you know. I'd see him, I'd ask him for money, you know, after the movie. But it was, at first I was afraid of him, but, you know, it was always, I was never really that impressed with Warhol himself, you know.
You were more impressed with Paul.
And with the whole
scene he created around him.
Hmm. Yeah,
because of course there's the famous story of when Trash, which was their biggest hit, let's face it, right. And you were the reason it was their biggest hit, opened. You were in, mm-hmm. not available to attend the premiere, shall we say?
No, I was in the clink. I was in the hooskow. But you know what, and I know.
She brings this is all in the book. That's why you have to read A Lowlife in High Heels, the Holly Woodlawn story.
Yeah, I went into the UN building and to the bank and as this French diplomat's wife and took $2,000 out of a bank account as Madame Chardonnay. The first time I got away with it, the second time! I went with Estelle. Well, I was hanging out with speed freaks that, you know, they want, you know, I was a patsy during this whole thing. So I went back and second time I was terrified, so I went across the street to this bar and got plowed. And then I don't know how I passed security, but I went and I went right up to the teller. I said, vive la France! I want to empty out the whole account. Hey, I'm going on the tour of the Rhine Valley. I don't know what, the wine country. Anyway, honey, the next thing I know, there's these two men and I'm being escorted, you know, and they took me into the women's house detention first and then well, they had no idea. They had no idea until it was time to search me. And then, you know, then it was like, you know, lift up your dress and just get him out of here. And then it was the men's house detention where I met Raoul, who wanted a quickie marriage.
Oh, I see. But, well, before we had... go on.
Oh, so anyway, to make a long story. So Trash opened during all this, and I'm running around jail screaming, I'm a superstar, you know. And then anyway, Trash opened, all these reviews. Andy wouldn't let me out because I just, you know... worked for them for six days, and finally Jackie got Larry Rivers to bail me out, so.
Right.
There I was.
and God, thank you, so God bless you for, you know, setting the record straight about what a great contribution both Jackie Curtis and Candy Darling made. And before we go, I have to say, years later, I caught up with you in London doing a nightclub act at Country Cousins, and she was the toast of the town. I mean, I was proud of you.
It was such a hoot to see you, my God. It was wonderful.
And I'm so, so happy that you were able to write this wonderful book, A Lowlife in High Heels. It's the essence of Christmas. Well, you're the human Christmas tree, aren't you? And everybody should run out and get this wonderful book. It won't look this big in the bookstores, but, you know, you'll have a big experience reading it. Thank you so much, Holly.
Oh, I love you. Thank you.
Oh, we must do this again.
Anytime, honey.
Okay.
Anytime.
Okay.
Stephen, there have been shows and there have been shows. But that was a show.
I know. That I one takes the cake. It's right up there with the best. And so are you, honey. Well, listen,
thanks.
Happy Christmas, as they say in England. Happy holidays. Happy Hanukkah. Happy 1992. We're going to have a great year, Susan.
It's going to be a great year. I think so.
We're going to go through the roof together. You know that. Oh, yeah. We're going to go all over America and continue. We're in our fourth season. Our 100th show is coming up real soon, which is going to be real special. We're going to have clips of all your favorite, you know, fabulous, outrageous moments from the Stephen Holt show. Anyway, so... this is goodbye from Stephen Holt.
Yes, and happy whatever you want it to be from Susan Haskins. happy trails to you.
Have a fabulous day.